Hi, my name is Bhumika, and this is the second lesson in the series of muscle contraction. And in this lesson, we're actually going to study the physiology of muscle contraction. So let's get started. The following steps are involved in muscle contraction, but before knowing this, you should be following the first lesson as all the main details they are stated in the first lesson. Okay, so the first step is the sequence of the events which lead to contraction. They are initiated somewhat in the CNS, which is the central nervous system, either as voluntary activity from the brain or as a reflex activity from the spinal cord. Now, a motor neuron which is present in the ventral horn of the spinal cord, it gets activated, and an action potential is it passes outward in a ventral root of the spinal cord. The axon branches to supply a number of muscle fibers, which is known as a motor unit, and the action potential is conveyed to a motor end plate on each muscle fiber. At the motor end plate, the action potential it causes the release of packets or quanta of acetylcholine into the synaptic clefts on the surface of the muscle fiber. So let us say that I touch my own hand. This message it goes on to the ventral horn of the spinal cord, and here it gets activated. So an action potential this way it is generated, and the axon it branches out to supply a number of muscle fibers. We pretty much know that, and this area is known as a motor unit. So this action potential it is converted to a motor end plate on each muscle fiber. At the motor end plate, this action potential it goes to the synaptic knob, where small packets of acetylcholine they are released in the synaptic cleft on the surface of the muscle fiber, which is supposed to produce a reaction. So this acetylcholine it causes the electrical resting potential under the motor end plate to change, and this then initiates an action potential which passes in both the directions along the surface of the muscle fiber. So the neuron which was present in action in resting potential it changes to action potential. And this then it just spreads in both the directions of the muscle fiber, and at the opening of each transverse tubules onto the muscle fiber surface, the action potential it spreads inside the muscle fiber. We must know that inside a little sarcolemma we've got transverse tubules. These transverse tubules they open up, and the action potential it spreads inside. Then what happens at each point where a transverse tubules it touch the parts of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, which is the endoplasmic reticulum of a sarcomere, it causes the sarcoplasmic reticulum to release calcium divalent ions. Now the action potential wherever it reaches that part of the transverse tubule which is in contact with the sarcoplasmic reticulum, it causes the release of a number of calcium divalent ions. These calcium ions they result in the movement of troponin and tropomyosin on their thin filament, and this enables the myosin molecule head to grab and swivel their way along the thin filament. This is the driving force of muscle contraction. Now, contraction is turned off by the following sequence of events. Let us first, diagrammatically understand how contraction is brought about. So, as you can see, we've got an axon terminal here, and we've got some synaptic vesicles. Then we also have acetylcholine receptors present on the motor end plate right here. So now the acetylcholine it is secreted from here, and it enters the synaptic cleft. Here it binds with its own particular receptors. Now here we've got the T tubule or the transverse tubule. Wherever it's in contact with the sarcoplasmic reticulum, a number of calcium divalent ions are secreted. As such, the myosin head it comes in contact with the actin, and contraction is brought about. So we can see Acetylcholine, it is released from the axon terminal, binds to receptors on the sarcolemma. Action potential is generated and it travels down the T tubule. Then calcium divalentines are released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum in response to the change in the voltage here. And Ca2 plus binds the troponin, cross bridges form between the actin and myosin, and as such, contraction is brought about. Now, how is this contraction turned off? Acetylcholine and the neuromuscular junction is broken down by acetylcholine esterase, which is an enzyme, and this terminates the stream of action potential along the muscle fiber surface. See, what happens is whenever the contraction has to turn off, this particular enzyme acetylcholine esterase is released. So it goes into the synaptic cleft and it cancels out all the acetylcholine molecules. So as such, the action potential which was generated, it is switched off. The sarcoplasmic reticulum, because it does not have any change of voltage, it will gather back all the Ca2 plus molecules, the ions, sorry, ceases to release the calcium ions and immediately starts to re-sequester all the calcium ions that have been released. Now, in the absence of calcium ions, a change in the configuration of troponin and tropomyosin then blocks the action of the myosin molecule heads and contraction ceases. Because the calcium ions are no more present, so on the troponin TPC unit there will be no calcium ions, and as such the sensitivity of actin towards myosin, it would be reduced. So both the head of the myosin, it will detach itself from the actin, and as such the contraction ceases. In the living animal, an external stretching force such as gravity or an antagonistic muscle pulls the muscle back to its original length. So, or diagrammatically, let's see, we've got acetylcholine esterase which comes here and it takes out all the acetylcholine molecules. So the sarcolemma plasma membrane here, the action potential is broken. So all these calcium ions which were secreted here, they go back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and see, the head which was adjoined here, it separates. So acetylcholine esterase, it removes acetylcholine from the synaptic cleft. Ca2 plus is transported back to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and tropomyosin binds actocytes and actin, causing the cross bridges to detach. Now there's a very common name which is used to refer to this whole physiology. It's called sliding filament theory. The molecular mechanisms of skeletal muscular contraction is explained in the sliding filament theory. It explains the mechanism of muscle contraction based on the muscle proteins that slide past each other to generate movement. Now, we knew that the myosin heads, they swiveled and slided their way in order to come in contact with the actin. So that is why this comes under the sliding filament theory. It was independently introduced in 1954 by two research teams, one consisting of Andrew F. Huxley and Rolf Nedejerk, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing the proper noun incorrectly, from the University of Cambridge, and the other consisting of Hugh Huxley and Gene Hansen from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. It was originally conceived by Huxley in 1953. Hugh Huxley in 1953, and Andrew Huxley and Nedejerk introduced it in a very attractive hypothesis. So if in the examination you are asked to write down the sliding filament theory, then of course you are supposed to write down the whole physiological contraction that I just explained to you. You mainly have to concentrate on how the myosin, it comes in contact with the actin, and you will have to write about how the Ca2 plus ions, they are released because of the action potential. So this is kind of related to the nervous system. Let's do sliding filament theory a bit more in detail. According to this theory, the actin, the thin filaments of muscle fiber, they slide past the myosin thick filaments during the muscle contraction, while the two groups of filaments, they remain relatively constant length. Before the 1950s, there were several competing theories on muscle contraction, including electrical attraction, protein folding, and protein modification. This novel theory, it directly introduced a new concept which is known as the cross bridge theory, which is the classically swinging cross bridge, now mostly referred to as the cross bridge cycle, which explained the molecular mechanism of the sliding filament theory. So as you can see, in a relaxed state, we had studied that these thicker bands, they were the myosin heads, and then we had the blue ones as the actin ones, and then we had titin, which connected all these to the adjacent sarcomere. We got the Z disc here, the I band, the lighter one, the central one. We've got the A band, and then we've got the lighter zone, the H zone, right in center. So this is the normal relaxed position. In the sliding filament theory, the contracted form is represented here. So what happens is the Z zones, they are pushed towards the center. Can you see that? This whole area right here, it is pushed towards the central zone right here. So this is the contracted form. If the sliding filament theory is asked in the examination, make sure you draw relaxed in a contracted form. You will get full marks. Nobody can deduct your marks if you explain your content with diagrams. So write down point to point procedure. It is very simple to understand, and do make certain diagrams including the relaxed state and the contracted state, because it helps the examiner that you basically understand the concept and you've not merely crammed it. If you like this tutorial, then you can follow me, rate me and review me. Thank you for watching, and if you think that you will be able to follow this if I explain this in Hindi, then I have also put out another course which is in Hindi, and you can watch the same tutorial in Hindi language as well. Thank you for watching.